Hello and welcome to this webinar brought to you by Bioanalysis and PPD. My name is Alex Glan and I'll be your host for today's event. I'm the Commissioning Editor for Future Science Group, publishers of the peer-reviewed journal Bioanalysis. We are very pleased to have here today Pierre Jolicoeur from PPD, who will be presenting to us on the detection of neutralizing antibodies against therapeutic proteins. One major challenge in bioanalysis of large molecules is the potential for provoking an unwanted immune response. This webinar covers the key steps in designing and testing a cell-based neutralizing antibody assay, including selecting a suitable cell line and choosing the proper cellular response, the endpoint method, as well as others. Pierre is responsible for all cell-based assay activities within PPD's Bioanalytical Laboratories Immunochemistry Division. As a member of the lab management team since 2006, Pierre's duties involve the oversight and implementation of complex research and development and validation projects designed to enhance and create bioanalytical methods and transfer client-provided methods. Before joining PPD, Pierre was Associate Director for Ligand Binding and Cell-Based Assay Services for another competitor contract research organization. He was responsible for coordinating all contracted work and managing the bioanalytical section. He also reviewed and approved all scientific, regulatory, and operational aspects of cell-based assays for clinical and non-clinical studies. Pierre's experience has also included positions such as the Manager for Research and Development and Viral Custom Services, as well as the Study Director for Preclinical Services at Kew Biogene. In today's webinar, Pierre will cover key steps in designing and testing a cell-based neutralizing antibody assay. We invite you to submit any questions you may have throughout the webinar using the questions option on your control panel, which should be located on the right-hand side of your screen. Questions will be addressed after Pierre's presentation and then followed up online on Bioanalysis Zone, which is also where you'll find a recording of today's event. I would now like to welcome our presenter, Pierre, invite him to share his research with you. Hi, Pierre.
Hi, Alex. How are you today?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
I'm doing very well, thank you. I want to thank you for the nice introduction, and I want to wish good day to everyone. And I also want to thank the organizers for inviting me today to present on a topic which has grown a lot of interest and attention over the past decade or so on the use of cell-based assays for the detection of neutralizing antibodies, or frequently known as NABs, against therapeutic proteins. And so today I will be providing guidance on the development and validation of cell-based NAB assays to drug products. So these are the topics that I will be covering in today's presentation. I will start with by providing a brief introduction on cell-based NAB assays, and then go over the different types of cell-based NAB assays, and then focus on assay development, troubleshooting, and validation. Then I'll talk briefly about assay transfer to CROs and end my presentation by providing a brief summary and conclusion of today's topic. So first, let's start with the basics. Neutralizing antibodies are generated as a result of an undesired immune response following the administration of a drug product such as growth factors, monoclonal antibodies, and cytokines. These antibodies, which are a subset of anti-drug antibodies, neutralize the biological activity of the drug product either by binding to specific sites on the drug product or by creating steric hindrance. NAB assays make use of mammalian cells to detect and quantify the presence of NABs in a variety of biological matrices. And this is accomplished by measuring a shift in a specific cellular response. NAB assays closely mimics the mechanism by which NABs may exert their effect in vivo, which is why they are preferred over the alternate plate-based NAB assays. So each cell-based NAB assay is unique in the sense that each drug product binds to a specific cell line and induces a specific cellular response. Additional factors impacting the final assay format include the drug product, the study population, whether healthy or disease state, and the study phase being either preclinical or clinical. The type of NAb assay depends on the drug's mechanisms of action. And shown on the right side of this slide are just some of the cellular responses that are commonly used in NAb assays. And so, why are NAb assays important? Well, as you probably know, many drug products currently being developed are large therapeutic molecules that carry the risk of provoking an unwanted immune response. This may result in the formation of anti-drug antibodies, which can lead to a range of clinical outcomes from no effect to severe harm due to altered efficacy, safety, or pharmacokinetics of the drug. In the case of drug products which are similar to endogenous molecules, NABs may also cross-react with the endogenous analyte in addition to the drug product. Therefore, samples that score positive for anti-drug antibodies must subsequently be tested for the presence of NABs. As a result, the FDA and other regulatory agencies have issued similar guidance documents regarding the development of valid sensitive assays for the detection, quantitation, and characterization of immunogenicity, including the assessment of neutralizing antibodies. It is strongly recommended that cell-based assays be developed whenever possible as part of immunogenicity studies. And so in addition to guidance papers from regulatory agencies, a number of white papers on development and validation of NAb assays are also used as guidelines. One point that I would like to make here is that if a cell-based assay cannot be developed, then a competitive ligand binding assay may be suitable. In such a case, it must be demonstrated that they reflect neutralizing capacity in an appropriate manner. And so while standard immunoassays such as ELISAs and RAs are used to detect anti-drug antibodies, these tests cannot detect neutralizing activity. And so detecting NABs requires the use of more specialized in vitro mammalian cell-based assays. I want to put the emphasis on the fact that both types of assays are useful and are not interchangeable, each providing a different set of information. And a good example of how these two technologies complement each other is the tiered approach currently used for screening samples for the presence of drug-specific antibodies, which is presented on this slide. So first, samples are screened using an immunoassay to detect the presence of drug-specific antibodies. Positive samples are then tested in a competitive inhibition and titer test. Samples remaining positive or reactive are then screened using a validated NAb assay, which is shown at the bottom of the slide. If the cellular response is normal, then samples do not contain any NABs and a negative result is reported as such. Samples with altered cellular responses are then confirmed also in a NAb assay, eliminating any possible false positives. The presence of NABs in direct assays is confirmed in a variety of ways, either by removing the antibodies from the sample, or and that is performed via depletion technique, or by testing the sample neat. A shift in cellular response indicates that the initial reactive sample did contain NABs. So there are two types of NAb assays, direct and indirect. The distinction is based on the drug's mechanism of action, which will be illustrated on the next few slides. Direct assays are generated by drug products that exert their effect directly on a cell, stimulating a specific cell response. As you can see on this slide, without neutralizing antibodies present, the drug product binds to a ligand-specific receptor on the cell surface and elicits a cellular response, such as cellular proliferation. In the presence of neutralizing antibodies, however, these bind to the drug product which prevents binding to the cell surface receptors, resulting in either decreased or an abrogated response. Now, this slide illustrates the main execution steps of a direct NAB assay, again using proliferation as the cellular response to the drug product. Step one is basically sample collection, and at this time of collection, it is not known whether or not the sample contains NABs. In step two, a specific drug concentration, which is determined and optimized during the development phase, is added to the sample and incubated to allow any NABs to bind to the drug product. In step three, the sample is transferred to a bioassay plate, allowed to interact with the cells, and further incubated. In step four, the cellular response is measured. In this example, increased cellular proliferation indicates that the drug product was able to bind to the ligand-specific receptor so that no NABs were present in the sample. When NABs are present, they bind to the drug product, preventing it from binding to the cells, producing a response. As you can see on this slide, indirect assays are used when the drug product, which is usually a monoclonal antibody or soluble receptor, works by blocking the binding of a ligand to its specific cell surface receptor. The end result is a reduction or absence of a cellular response. When NABs are present, they bind to the drug product, preventing it from binding to the cellular receptors. As a result, the ligand can bind to its receptor and trigger a specific cellular response, such as cellular proliferation that you can see on this slide. The main steps involved in performing an indirect NAB assay are illustrated on this slide. Again, steps 1 to 3 are the same for direct and indirect assays. For indirect assays, a new step, which is number 4 here, must be included to add the ligand and incubate. If the sample does not contain NABs, the ligand-specific receptor is blocked by the drug product, and the ligand itself cannot bind to the cell. If NABs are present, they bind to the drug product, leaving the ligand-specific receptor open for binding with the ligand. Step 5 then measures the cellular response. In this example, the ligand triggers cellular proliferation. So a sample without NABs exhibits decreased proliferation, and a sample with NABs results in increased cellular proliferation, as shown on this slide. So now that we've covered pretty much all the basics and principles behind cell-based NAB assays, let's move to the development aspect. And so there are a number of parameters that are typically evaluated during the development of NAB assays. The key development steps include selecting a suitable cell line, choosing the proper cellular response, also known as the endpoint method, selection of the assay controls, and optimization of assay parameters. And so selecting a suitable cell line is a very first step during the development process. And so there are many factors to consider when selecting a cell line for use in a NAB assay. The cell line chosen must yield a specific response to the drug product and must provide the proper sensitivity and dynamic range to measure that response. Cell line also must be able to tolerate the culture conditions and sample matrix from the drug of interest and disease state under investigation. As with all cell-based assays, the background and culture media must be carefully selected to avoid interference with the assay, and the cells must be monitored for changes induced by multiple passages. The cell banking process involves expanding or scaling up the cell line of choice and generating a sufficient number of vials to support the validation and sample analysis processes. After scale-up, cells should be tested for mycoplasma and sterility. Use of antibiotics such as penstrep in cell culture media is really not advisable because they may mask contaminations that could impact assay performance either by interacting with a component of the assay or by preventing cells from responding. As vials are usually kept in a vapor phase, liquid nitrogen for long-term storage, cells should be tested for stability in a cell-based assay to demonstrate consistency of assay performance over time. Just a quick note here on cell line engineering. So stable long-term gene expression is usually achieved via integration of the plasmid into the target cell's genome. Episomal stability is in most cases limited either as a result of a gradual loss of transfected vectors or random integration leading to silencing of the gene of interest. Transfected expression plasmid must carry the appropriate promoter for optimal expression levels in the desired cell line. Stably transfected cells can be selected by the addition of drugs to the culture medium and by ensuring that the expression plasmid also carries a drug resistance gene. Since cells differ in their susceptibility to selection markers such as G41A, which also depends on cell density, a titration curve using increasing concentrations of the drug of interest and cell density must be performed. Additional consideration must be given to specific critical areas of the process, such as a possible genetic drift with time associated with a loss of functionality, especially when the selective pressure is removed from the culture media. Clonal stability, again, which is the performance of the clone, ensuring consistent sensitivity, dynamic range, and reproducibility of the assay performance. You also know to me, you need to make sure that your clone or your cell line is free of any mycoplasma. Finally, if cell-based NAP assays require the use of recombinant viruses, well, purified virus preparations that must be assessed for stability and infectivity over time and titered accordingly should be used either through a TCID50 or a plaque assay. Additionally, the MOI or multiplicity of infection needs to be determined during the validation stage as this is a critical assay parameter. And so the second step is to choose a proper cellular response or the endpoint method. So again, the basis for detecting NAPs is a shift in an assay-specific cellular response, which depends on the drug's mechanism of action. This endpoint must be specific and must provide the necessary sensitivity to measure changes mediated by the drug of interest. Cellular responses can be categorized as either early responses, such as receptor binding and phosphorylation, detection of cytoplasmic cyclic AMP or ATP, signal transduction specific protein phosphorylation, or late responses such as cellular proliferation, apoptosis, cytokine production, and reported gene expression such as fluorescence, luminescence, which are pictured on this slide. One of the most important aspects of developing cell-based assays is to ensure that you have the proper controls in place. The reason is that each of these controls validates a specific component of the NAP assay to ensure that a positive result is a true indication of the presence of NAPs. The three main controls that are central to NAP assays are the negative control, the ligand control, as well as the drug control. The negative control uses samples from multi-drug naive donors to test for any possible interaction between the sample matrix and the cells in culture. No drug, antibodies, or ligand are present. The inclusion of donors affected by the targeted disease state is also important because the disease may alter the matrix response by increasing cytokine levels and triggering nonspecific cell stimulation, for instance. In most cases, the samples are diluted before use to minimize matrix interference. The negative control is also used to determine tolerance to matrix, specifically the MRD, which is the minimum required dilution, which is the highest volume of sample matrix that has minimal or no impact on assay performance. Then comes the ligand control, which is added as part of indirect assays and evaluates the potential cell stimulation caused by the ligand in the presence of the sample matrix. No drug products or drug-specific antibodies are present. In a similar fashion, the drug control is used to assess interactions between the sample matrix, cells, ligand, if appropriate, and drug in the absence of antibodies. As far as the positive control is concerned, the identification of a positive control antibody that is capable of neutralizing the biological activity of the drug product of interest is crucial. While antibodies from subjects who have been tested positive for NAbs are ideal, most PC antibodies are produced in animals that have been exposed to the drug product. Positive control antibodies are used to assess assay sensitivity, which is defined as the lowest concentration of antibodies that can be detected using the optimal drug concentration, cell density, and ligand concentration in the case of indirect assays. In terms of assay format, direct assay should have, in addition to the positive control, the negative control, and the drug control, and generate the appropriate ratios from these controls. For direct assays, both the appropriate drug concentration and the cell density need to be determined. Since the sensitivity of the assay depends on the drug concentration, the lowest concentration that yields at least 50% of the total cellular response within the linear portion of the curve is targeted, then optimized to provide the best dynamic range and sensitivity. Cell density is optimized based on signal-to-noise ratio in assay sensitivity. So this is an example of a drug-induced receptor phosphorylation, which was assessed using a range of drug and cell concentrations. All these response curves should plateau at the low and the high end portion of the curve and have a linear portion in between, which is used for data calculation. Again, the lowest concentration, which yielded 50% of the total response, was determined in that case first and then optimized. Again, it is important to use the lowest drug concentration that provides adequate sensitivity, as higher drug concentrations may result in strong cellular responses that will not be measurably altered in the presence of very low concentrations of NAb. Indirect assays are optimized in a similar manner, first determining the lowest ligand concentration that achieves the ED50, and then calculating the lowest drug concentration that causes at least a 50% inhibition of the ligand before performing any further optimization assays. Again, this is a typical ligand curve for indirect assays. Again, the ED50 was determined using an optimal cell density and a range of ligand concentration. This is a typical drug curve testing a range of drug concentrations using an optimal cell density. In this figure, Three concentrations spanning the 80/50 of the drug product were tested during the optimization process. Drug concentration 1, seen here, was chosen as the final concentration to be used in the assay, as it generated the most appropriate dose response curve. So other factors that can influence the assay, including cell incubation conditions, reagents or equipment, and cell stimulation conditions, require additional development work before the assay can be validated. Changes in the performance of the assay also should be evaluated as a function of the number of passages and or days in culture to avoid variability due to these factors. Additional assay parameters that need optimization include incubation time between the drug and or ligand and the cells, as well as the sample MRD, the choice of reagents, equipment, and stimulation conditions. Now, assays are often developed from potency assays, which makes the process a bit easier since the cell line, drug concentration, and their associated parameters are already established and only need to be tweaked in the presence of matrix of interest. Additional considerations should be directed at factors involved in generating a non-specific cell response that may result in a false positive. Cells may be responsive to multiple stimuli triggered by matrix components such as cytokines, soluble receptors, pre-existing antibodies, or endogenous proteins present as a result of a particular disease. In such cases, additional controls must be in place to ensure the specificity of the assay in lack of interference. Moving on to the assay cut point now. The assay cut point is statistically determined and is the response level above or below which a sample is deemed positive. I will be providing more information on that crucial parameter a little bit later in my presentation. In some cases, the presence of the drug product in matrix samples can interfere with the assay's ability to detect NAbs. So when high drug concentrations or drug tolerance or matrix interference are expected, NAbs are often removed from the matrix with a specific binding method followed by an acid dissociation step. Using such an approach before proceeding with sample analysis allows for an accurate assessment or measurement of neutralizing activity. We have been very successful in validating a number of cell-based assays using a combination of acid dissociation and or removal steps. The choice of the method and the approach depends on whether the NAbs need to be removed from the matrix or high levels of drug-bound NAbs need to be dissociated. So given the nature and complexity of cell-based NAb assays, troubleshooting can be a challenging task. The most efficient approach usually involves careful study of the data generated from controls to assess potential root causes. And on this slide, I have summarized problems that can occur in one or a combination of four key areas. And so the first one is relates to cells, cell line stability and performance. So one needs to make sure that passage number or time in culture as a function of assay performance was evaluated. You also need to look at stability of cell surface receptor expression for engineered cell lines that can be assessed using flow cytometry technology. You also need to monitor change in cell culture media or serum with respect to brand or lot numbers. You also need to observe for any potential change in growth pattern or cell morphology. You also need to make sure to assess whether or not you've tested your cell line for mycoplasma or other possible contamination. You also need to look at whether or not your cells were banked properly and stored according to the expected process. You also need to perform stability assessment if your cells are stored for a long period of time. Then the second category deals with reagents. And so stability and activity of drug product or ligand, especially if a new lot is used, need to be assessed. If there's a change in a positive control or detection antibodies, species, purification process need to be looked at as well. Also, if specialized plates are used, then you need to look and determine whether or not there's been a change in the lot number. Possible lot-to-lot variability should be determined during the development process. In a similar fashion, you need to look at any change in lot number of your detection kits. But the biological activity need to be assessed, especially with specialized reagents such as complement. We have observed huge variability when using complement and changing, you know, from one lot to another. So you need to keep that in mind as well. The third category is instrumentation. So you need to look for any change in the instrumentation parameters for your specific assay. You need to make sure that your instrument was had maintenance performed or adjustment performed as well. You need to look at possible changes, fluctuations in CO2 concentration, humidity, or temperature. If you introduce a new brand or model of a critical equipment, something as simple as shakers, for instance, need to be looked at as well. You need to look at change in pipette type from, let's say, going from a single channel to a multi-channel. If there were any changes in the tips that are typically used for your assay. You also need to make sure that your pipettes were properly calibrated as well. And the last category relates to assay format and execution. So obviously you need to review the method and ensure that steps have not been modified. Ensure that change in pipetting techniques or the dilution scheme of your samples and controls have not changed as well. Maybe you'll want to have the assay execute by a second or more experienced analyst to determine if there's people-to-people variability. You also need to look for possible matrix interference if that was not performed during the validation, during the development, early during the development process. And determine potential differences between healthy and diseased subjects and assess potential matrix-related interfering components. So these are the main areas that you should be looking at if you're experiencing issues with your assay. So now that our assay has been fully developed, we can now move to the actual validation step. So method validation is the process by which an analytical procedure employed for a specific test and a specific analyte is shown to be suitable for its intended use. Results from method validation can be used to measure the quality, reliability, and consistency of analytical results. Validating NAB assays is a complex, multi-step process involving several scientists in order to evaluate assay robustness. And typically shown here on this slide are the parameters that are assessed during the validation. So the first one is the assay cut point. And so the screening assay cut point, or ACP, is the screening assay value at or above which a sample is negative and below which a sample is positive, or vice versa for indirect assays, and requires further testing in a confirmatory or specificity assay. To determine the screening assay cut point, we typically use at least 30 individual matrix lots for preclinical studies and 50 individual lots for clinical studies that are analyzed three times by a minimum of two different scientists over at least 2 days. Statistical analysis is then performed to ensure normality of the population and lack of outliers. The data is then calculated to provide a cut point, typically with an upper negative limit of 95%, which allows for the detection of 5% of false positives. The specificity assay value and the confirmatory assay value are determined in the same manner, with individual matrix lots analyzed three times over the course of two runs and by two different scientists. Then comes inter-assay and intra-assay precision. To assess the inter-assay precision, the positive control antibodies typically spike into the pooled matrix and analyze in at least one replicate on each validation plate. To assess the intra-assay precision, multiple replicates are analyzed on at least one plate. The negative ligand and drug controls should also be monitored for precision during the validation. As far as assay sensitivity is concerned, well, to determine the assay sensitivity as well as the lower limit of detection, or LLD, the positive control is spiked into the pool matrix at specific concentrations. The LLD is defined as the lowest concentration where specific NAB antibodies can be detected 100% of the time. And so titration curves are generated and analyzed at least three times by at least two different analysts on multiple days. Precision is assessed by generating statistical analysis for between-day precision, between-curve precision, and within-day precision. The cut point is related to the assay's limit of detection, which is the smallest or lowest concentration of the positive control that yields a positive result. And so the lowest concentration of positive control that is below the screening assay cut point in all the runs will determine the assay sensitivity. Preclinical studies tend to target an assay sensitivity of 500 to 1,000 nanograms per ml of serum, while the FDA guidance suggests an assay sensitivity range of 250 to 500 nanograms per ml for most clinical trials. Moving on now to the LLD or matrix recovery. Again, the LLD is validated using several individual matrix samples, both untreated matrix, which mimics pre-dose samples, and matrix spiked at the LLD concentration, analyzed over the course of several runs by two scientists. The mean response, standard deviation, and percent CV for each sample is calculated and reported. For each individual result, the screening assay value is calculated and reported. As far as the confirmation of assay cut points is concerned, it is good practice to verify that the cut points derived through the validation process will accurately detect NABs in samples of the matrix of interest. All cut points should be confirmed by testing a number of individual matrix samples. Again, both untreated serum samples and serum samples spiked at the LLD are tested several times on at least two different days by at least two different analysts. Each sample is typically analyzed using both the screening and confirmatory assays. As far as drug interference is concerned, to assess the potential issue of this parameter, the matrix is spiked with several concentrations of the drug product. The drug spike samples are analyzed along with multiple PC samples at concentrations above the assay LLD to determine the amount of drug that interferes with the detection of NABs. the ability to detect NAbs in hemolyzed samples is determined in a similar fashion by spiking the positive control at multiple concentrations in samples exhibiting increasing concentration of hemolysis. Then comes stability. So the stability of NAbs is expected to be similar to the stability of any antigen-specific serum or plasma immunoglobulin, regardless of the target, and therefore short and long-term stability studies for immunogenicity methods may not be necessary. However, these studies may be conducted if needed and mock samples such as surrogate control spiking to matrix can be used. During assay validation, matrix freeze-thaw and thawed matrix stability are obtained to evaluate the integrity of the controls under different short-term storage and handling conditions. To determine freeze-thaw stability of neutralizing antibodies, the controls are subjected to a pre-specified number of freeze-thaw cycles prior to analysis. The number of cycles depends on the needs of the tiered approach as well as future plans for the assay system. Each cycle typically consists of keeping the sample frozen for at least 24 hours for the first cycle and for at least 12 hours for all subsequent cycles, and then thawing the samples at room temperature. To determine room temperature stability of neutralizing antibodies, the controls are allowed to stay at room temperature for at least 24 hours prior to analysis. And so that completes the NAP assay validation portion. And I would now like to talk very briefly about assay transfers to CROs, since the industry has observed a huge increase in outsourcing bioanalytical work to CROs over the past decade or so. So for an assay developed internally by a sponsor, the point between optimization and validation is an ideal time to consider outsourcing the work to a CRO. As the pharmaceutical industry continues to experience considerable pressure to streamline the drug development process, CROs can offer cost-effective methods to scale up assays for the increased number of samples that accompany the advancement of a drug through the pipeline. Outsourcing eliminates the need to expand the sponsor's laboratory, whether through purchasing capital equipment, hiring staff, or both, and also frees up existing personnel to concentrate on other development projects. And so outsourcing an assay is fastest and most efficient when scientists from the sponsor and CRO work together at a single location. Close collaboration and effective communication between the teams allows issues to be resolved quickly. During the transfer process, parameters that must be evaluated include PC, the DC dilution schemes, the MRD sensitivity, reagent preparation and settings and specifications on key equipment such as incubators, shakers, and plate readers that may differ between the sponsor and the CRO. And so assay transfer can be costly and time-consuming, making it vital for the sponsor to choose a reputable contract laboratory with state-of-the-art instrumentation and qualified personnel who can minimize the inherent learning curve. And so to summarize and conclude today's presentation, let's say that as the use of therapeutic proteins increases, the risk of immunogenicity and the formation of neutralizing antibodies increase as well. Cell-based assays are well suited for detecting NAbs because they mimic the mechanism by which NAbs and the drug interact in vivo. Again, each NAb assay is unique and complex, and a careful and thorough assessment and validation of multiple factors, including reagents, assay controls, matrix interference, as well as other conditions, will help to ensure sensitive, specific, and robust assay. And so that concludes my coverage of the cell-based NAP assay, and I will now turn the floor over to questions and to you, Alex.
Thank you, Pierre, for sharing your research with us here at Bioanalysis Zone. I hope our audience found your talk as insightful and interesting as I did. If you do have any questions for Pierre, please feel free to send them now by using your control panel on the right-hand side of your screen. Alternatively, please send your questions to info@bioanalysis-zone.com. We have actually already received quite a lot of questions, so Pierre, if you're happy to, shall we answer some of these now, live on air?
Absolutely. So
the first one is, can you provide a detailed example of an endpoint method used in a cell-based assay?
Absolutely. Very good question. Again, the choice of the appropriate endpoint method depends on the drug's mechanism of action. And again, we've successfully used a variety of cellular responses in NAB assays. And obviously, we could provide multiple examples, but since I touched a little bit on cell line engineering, let me provide you with one example in which a cell line was engineered. That's a kit that is available through PPL. And so say that many gene reporter assays use gene fluorescent proteins in a variety of constructs and or luciferase. For example, cell-based assays used to detect NAB assays against interferon may be adapted from the commercially available human interferon luciferase gene reporting ILite kit, which is available from PPL interferon source in New Jersey. These ILite cells are division arrested, one-time use, frozen human U937 cells stably transfected with the firefly luciferase reporter gene under the control of an interferon-sensitive responsive element. And so upon stimulation, the drug product binds to the interferon receptor on the ILite cell surface and produces luminescence by induction of the interferon-sensitive response element and enhance the luciferase reporter gene. The luminescence intensity is proportional to the amount of drug product stimulant. So when NABs are present, they bind to the drug product and prevent it from stimulating the cell surface receptors and therefore producing luminescence. Samples are scored preliminary reactive for NABs if the luminescence readout falls below statistically determined cut point at a single sample dilution. If the luminescence readouts are at or above the cut point, then the samples are considered negative for NAPS.
Brilliant. Thank you very much for your very interesting answer. Another question. Can you provide an example of a compound in a diseased matrix that can interfere in the neutralizing antibody assay?
Absolutely. Very good question as well. It is well known, again, that serum or plasma components may influence assay results, as it usually is usually necessary to dilute patient samples for testing to minimize such effects. And I'll provide just quickly two types of compounds that we typically, find in disease matrix. As we know, matrix can also cause interference, particularly as seroplasma components may enhance or inhibit the activity of a therapeutic protein in bioactivity assays. The first example are sera from patients with particular diseases which may contain elevated levels of cytokines. These cytokines may serve to activate cells in a bioassay and obscure the presence of neutralizing antibodies. Also, both immunoassays and cell-based NAB assays can be subjected to interference from endogenous antibodies, either anti-animal antibodies, rheumatoid factors, and other antibodies. And these endogenous antibodies can create both false positives and false negative results by changing the binding ability of the target allied or assay antibodies. So for example, people with rheumatoid arthritis or other autoimmune diseases, and sometimes even in the normal population, these people may produce high concentrations of what we call the RF factor in their blood. And the RF factor is typically an IgM class antibody that recognizes the Fc region of these immunoglobulins. And so the RF factor can bind not only to human IgG, but also to immunoglobulins from other species. And so the use of techniques such as ways around that is the use of aspartam or anti-RF antibodies that are used as a blocking reagent. And these two approaches have, you know, proven to be effective approaches to controlling the RF factor in these assays. And so in cases like that, the FDA recommends that the minimum dilution from a panel of at least 10 samples from the untreated patient population be determined. There's typically always a need to dilute patient samples to maintain a reasonable ability to detect anti-product antibodies and so sensitivity. Ideally, the minimum dilution is the dilution that yields a signal close to the signal of non-specific binding of an assay diluent.
Brilliant, Pierre. Thank you for your answer. Another question from our audience is, can you elaborate on MRD determination mostly used in your lab?
Yes, for each assay, obviously, that is a critical component of during the development stage, and MRD needs to be considered. So the lowest dilution or lowest concentration of your matrix that does not impact the ability of the cells to detect neutralizing antibodies typically is chosen. And that's that has always been our approach, basically. You want to make sure that you don't dilute your matrix too much, otherwise you lose sensitivity. So you need to strike a good balance between having the most sensitive assay and yet having a dilution that will prevent your background interference, which obviously will not allow you to detect in a specific manner and in an accurate manner your neutralizing antibodies.
And what can we do if there are lots of free drug in the testing samples?
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question?
Of course. What can we do if there are lots of free drug in the testing samples?
Well, again, in cases where you have a lot of free drug in your sample, what one should do is, and obviously if it's a concentration that is too high to allow you to detect neutralizing antibodies, you need to remove these these NABs in the sample. So what you can do is you can label your drug product and add at a very high concentration that labeled drug product in your sample. That drug product will bind to the NABs, and then that allows you to fish out the NABs, removing the NABs from your matrix. And you basically end up working in a matrix free environment. You then proceed by performing an acid dissociation step, which will free the neutralizing antibodies, and that will allow you to proceed with your assay in detecting these neutralizing antibodies.
Brilliant, thank you for that. And I've got one more question for our audience. Have you encountered a situation where false positive or negatives were found in subjects, positive and negative QCs were still okay?
Can you repeat that question again, please?
Yeah, sure. Have you encountered a situation where false positive or negatives were found in subjects, but positive and negative QCs were still okay?
We have not to this date encountered that that problem, and probably because of our evaluation scheme, when you go through the initial screening assay and then confirmatory assay, and that's why we have a confirmatory assay in place, we make sure that if your samples are positive in your screening assay, then you test your samples in your confirmatory assay to, again, confirm the presence of neutralizing antibodies. Sometimes if there's a possibility of your pre-dose samples to contain some type of neutralizing antibodies, or maybe provide a false positive, some type of unspecific signal, then one approach is to generate another cut point by evaluating the pre-dose over the post-dose and establishing a ratio, or post-dose over pre-dose. And that allows you to determine if you have a net, basically, signal. So that's another approach that we've used in some cases where some people were concerned about possible either matrix interference or matrix components that could provide a false, signal.
Brilliant. Thank you very much for that. And can you provide an example where developing a cell-based assay was not possible? And if so, were there any regulatory challenges using an alternative approach?
We've had a couple of instances where the cell line was not available, where engineering a cell line was attempted and failed. Or where the basically assay sensitivity was not, the assay was not sensitive enough, and therefore the alternate method, which is using a plate-based assay, was used instead.
Well, thank you for that. And I think we've got one more question from our audience. Is, have you chosen a drug concentration lower than EC50 in order to maximize sensitivity of the assay? And if so, what is your recommended minimum dynamic range of the neutralizing antibody assay?
In terms of dynamic range, obviously it depends. It varies from one assay to another. We like to see the best dynamic range possible. Anything I would say below 4 or 5 to 1 when you compare the maximum self-stimulation over your negative control is preferable. We have not had so far had to go below that concentration, but that doesn't mean that it can't happen. Obviously, with drug products that are extremely potent and that requires very small amounts, and in combination of when you use a very sensitive or responsive cell line, obviously you would want to go below the ED50. Typically, we evaluate our range between 50 and 70%. That's typically what we've done so far. But again, that needs to be carefully evaluated for each assay.
Brilliant. Thank you very much for that, Pierre. I think that's all we have time for today, so I'd just like to thank all our audience members and everyone for participating in this webinar. And if you do have any questions, that these can be addressed offline and sent to info@bioanalysis-zone.com. Once again, I'd like to thank our wonderful presenter, Pierre, for his talk, and to all our listeners for their time and insightful questions. We'll be sending you a link to the recorded version of today's talk, so if you do have any comments, please do not hesitate to get in touch. Finally, I wanted to take this opportunity to offer my congratulations to Dr. Jolicoeur for the upcoming publication of his article in the December issue of Bioanalysis on the development and validation of cell-based assays for the detection of neutralizing antibodies to drug products, a practical approach. Thank you again for everyone for participating. If you have any comments or feedback, please contact us at info@bioanalysiszone.com. Thank you again.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.